5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go!
Oke, bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Good morning everyone. It's nice to be here again in Shardos Sharing Dosen sesi kelima ya. And for today, it will be about textbook analysis with the amazing speakers for today. Ada Miss Rahmatillah MPD and Mr. Agus Hidayat from UIN Raden Intan Lampung, and also Miss Elvira Roshida from Universitas Negeri Malang ya, Miss. Yeah. Okay, and then for the audience, especially for the students that joined today, please say something, please ask anything about textbook analysis, karena di sini ada pakar-pakar textbook analysis, so you can ask anything about that. Well, langsung start saja ya. Let's start the presentation from the first speaker. Who will be the first speaker? Ms. Rahmatillah or Mr. Agus? Or Ms. Elvira?
Ms. Elvira ya, Ms.
Okay. Saya, Bu.
Yeah, so for the first speaker will be Ms. Elvira. Time is yours, Ms. Elvira.
Okay, thank you so much Ms. Nuna for the chance given to me. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Yeah, first of all, I'd like to say thank you so much for PBI UINRIL who invite me to join this nice sharing station, sharing lesson, in 5 edition. Yeah, actually, I'm not an expert about textbook analysis, and PBI UINRIL already has Ibu Rahmatillah, Ms. Rahmatillah, and also Mr. Agus who have, I think, a deeper knowledge and an experience in this course. That yeah, just try to share, want to share my experience, especially in when I conduct the research on textbook analysis. Well, I want to share my PPT. Terlihat?
Iya,
ya, kelihatan nih.
Kelihatan. Muncul ya?
Di slideshow aja, Miss, biar lebih gede.
Oke. Ya. This is the, here are the topics that I want to share in this session. The first one is the role of textbooks, and then textbook evaluation and evaluation criteria, and then studies on textbook evaluation. Okay. Yes, you know that textbooks as one of instructional materials that support the language instruction and teaching learning process. There are many EFL experts that define textbooks in many ways, but in these slides, I took the definition of textbooks from Ur and then Hutchison and Torres and then Mansur. They define textbooks as a structurally sourced book used as a core of learning medium consisting of text, images, detailed information, and lesson plans on the particular subject that is systematically followed by the teachers and the students in order to reach a particular educational outcomes. Yeah, textbooks are often referred to a core source for teaching, learning, and classroom interaction. Almost all teachers, but in fact, almost all teachers use published textbooks in their teaching. Okay, I'm sorry, my baby. Maaf, ke-distract dengan suara baby. Oke, kita lanjut sebentar. Oke. Tadi sampai di almost all teachers use published textbooks in their teaching. But textbooks are widely used by teachers because the textbooks have the following roles. And the first one is textbooks provide a readily available source of language teaching materials for a teacher to focus on doing the real work of teaching. It means that textbooks have or with their supplementary components such as teacher's guides, workbooks, and then tests, and then other audiovisual devices can provide usable and necessary classroom work for general language courses. And it is can be as important source of information in teaching. And the second one is textbook can train the teachers. It means that textbooks help the teachers to reskill. It means that textbooks with their teachers guidance teachers manuals give teachers instruction on how to carry out the lesson. And then the textbooks also help the teachers save time, of course, on lesson preparation and materials production. And textbooks also help the teachers to have more time to think about creating interesting and effective the classroom activity to introduce the given content of knowledge to the students. And then the last one is for students, the textbooks can keep track of the students' development, or it can be said that textbooks are sometimes considered to over like a map, clear map to, for the teachers and the students to follow, as they indicate where they are, and then what they have done, what the students and teacher have done in the class, and then what needs to be done to fill a specific course aim of it. Or it can be stated, textbooks help their students to review and practice what they have learned. However, we have to be careful of the weaknesses of the textbooks, since as we know that that published textbooks are commercially products, right? So we have to be careful of them, that sometimes textbook do not meet all the teachers and the students need, such as the textbooks maybe it's not relevant to the students' background, or sometimes the textbooks are non-authentic. But in general, the role of textbooks is various, depend on the teacher experience and then also the pedagogical methods. No matter how well or how good, how well the textbooks are written, the teachers or evaluators should make sure that they use textbooks carefully, because too much relies on the textbooks is does not open the world, but it will limit it. So how do we know whether the textbooks that the teacher or evaluator will use or being used is good or appropriate with the curriculum or with the students' need? Yeah, the teacher needs the process of evaluating, selecting the textbooks before using. And here are the reasons for textbook evaluation. And the first one is evaluation help the selection, which serves as an important decision-making process, and then as a judgment on how well the textbook has performed in fact, and then it provides valuable information for the future going of classroom practice, the planning of courses, and the management of learning tasks by the students, and then to identify the particular strengths and weaknesses in the textbooks already in use. Yeah, it can be said that the textbook evaluation as a way to measure whether a program functions as been explained, and it helps the teacher decide whether they want to continue to using the textbook, previous textbooks, or modifying, adjusting, or rejecting some programs or materials provided in the textbook. And there are many approaches or stages that of textbook evaluation proposed by experts. Yeah, one of them is proposed by Richards. I forget to write the year. Richards and Tomlinson who divide the stages of textbook evaluation into three stages. The first one is pre-use evaluation, and then in-use evaluation, and post-use evaluation. In pre-use evaluation, it's like a prediction or an initial step of textbook evaluation. Once after a textbook is published, teachers or evaluators can make a judgment of this book. It involves assessing the potential part of value or materials for the user, including activity like a quick scan of books, a physical appearance, and then content pages to get the first impression of the textbooks. It's like to give a very general purpose of evaluation without any specific criteria to look for. Yeah. And then in use evaluation, it involves the evaluating the materials in use. It is more objective than previous evaluation. Yeah, it involves the deeper evaluation, like the content of materials, and then it can make use of classroom observation and feedback from the students. Yeah. And then in post-use evaluation, in this stage, most teachers or evaluators tend to see the answer to such a question like, what is the impact of the textbooks on the students? Or what is its impacts on the teacher? Yeah. In this stage, the evaluation process involves measuring the effects on the materials on the students after the textbooks has been used. Okay. And then the next approach for stages on textbook evaluation is derived from Little John and McQuaid. Yeah, who propose the textbook evaluation into three level. First one is level 1, yeah, level 2, and level 3. At the first level, there are questions about the physical properties of the textbooks. It's similar to the textbook evaluation proposed by Tomlinson. Yeah. Like types of materials, the physical aspect, design, use of colors on the textbook. And then in level 2, what is required of users means that this level focus on the language learning activities and then tasks in the textbooks to see what teachers and students using the textbooks need to do. And then in level three, it includes selection and sequencing of the content, so the same tasks, and then distribution of information across the teacher and the students' components. What is involved? Similar like the previous approaches. Okay, textbook evaluation is, I think, is a complex matter that there are so many variables that will affect this success or failure of the textbooks in a particular course of instruction. And yeah, in carrying out an evaluation, the teachers as the evaluators need to take many decisions. One is the selection of criteria for evaluation, because yeah, there are no perfect checklist that can be used. Yeah, the evaluation criteria may vary and depend on the specific background or there is specific of teaching and learning context, and there are many usable approaches and checklists for evaluation. Yeah, for evaluation criteria have been proposed by Baird, Scherzo, Bupsia, Sandan, yeah, and so many experts that propose evaluation textbooks evaluation. Okay. I will show you an example of checklist. Yeah, this is the combination from Baird, Scherzo, Murcia, another expert. Ya, banyak sekali poin-poinnya di sini bisa dijabarkan dan bisa kita adopsi untuk melakukan evaluasi pada textbook.
Okay, that's all, Miss Elvira. Oh, belum ya?
Belum. Yeah, actually, every approaches and checklist has its own strengths and weaknesses, and the teachers or evaluators should choose an approach which is the most principal, systematic, and suitable for their context. Yeah, and yeah, in my opinion, it is also important for the teachers to combine approaches in order to cover the weaknesses of one approach with the strength of others. Okay, yeah, no matter what guidelines or checklists which are teachers adopted to carry out the textbook evaluation. Probably the most important principle is that the teacher have to try to figure out the fit between materials and the curriculum, the students and the teacher. And the next slide, I will share my experience when I conduct my research. It has been 5 years ago. Yeah. It's about the teacher's perception toward the use of MS textbooks. And the objectives are, first one is to investigate teachers' perception toward the use of MS textbooks in the UPL class, and then to identify the factors that influence teachers' perception toward the use of MS textbooks, and to investigate teacher experience, not only in selecting and evaluating the textbook, but also experience in analyzing, organizing, interpreting and integrating these textbooks, and to find out the problems that arise while selecting, analyzing, organizing, interpreting, integrating these textbooks. And this method, the study is a case study, yeah, the investigate teacher perception toward the use of MS textbooks, and also to explore their experience. And then the subject are where English teachers, they were teaching this at the 12th grade at the time in SMA Negeri 3 Surakarta, and then to collect the data and to answer the questions, the research questions. I used questionnaire, semi-structured interview, and non-participant observation. And because this is a case study, the data were analyzed by using interactive model. And yeah, those are the results. The teachers believe that they have to consider some consideration to check what is actually contained in the textbooks, that they do not always follow all the sequence of the materials and activities suggested by the textbook authors, but based on the student's need. And they reveal that the students should go hand in hand with the supplementary teaching materials to serve students' need, even though they are relatively satisfied, being satisfied with the textbook's choice. And the second one is teacher perception are influenced by some. Yeah.
Yeah, you still have 4 minutes to present your presentation.
Okay, this is the last. Thank you. Influenced by some factors such as experience, needs, situation, and students' interest, students' ability, and a workshop or training and references. And the teachers take part in each step of the procedure for the textbook selection. Then they analyze, then describe each component in the textbooks, and the teachers organize materials and activity in each unit of the textbooks based on the lesson plan they make and their students need. And the division time and different view among teachers are two major problems faced by the teacher when conducting textbook evaluation and analysis. Okay. Yeah. That's all. Thank you, Ms. Lennon. Back to you.
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Elvira, for the nice presentation. And we move to the next speaker. Siapa ini? Ms. Rahmatila or Mr. Agus? Ms. Rahmatila. Okay. Ms. Rahmatila, you have 30 minutes to present your material. Time is yours.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Neron. First of all, I would like to say thanks to Jurusan or PBI for giving me a chance to share my knowledge about textbook analysis and how to analyze it and blah, blah, blah. Okay. And also for the participant here, my beloved student here, I hope that you will get the beneficial after you heard about some theory or to you. And then you have to stay tuned because at the end of my presentation, I will share about my project of textbook analysis. And for the student who don't have a proposal or who don't have a research, you can, this is the alternative for you to do a research about the textbook. Okay, I will show my, I will share my screen. Okay. Oke, seperti tadi lagi ternyata ya. Sebentar. Agak sulit. Sebentar ya. Stop. I have to stop my screen here. Oke. Oke. Miss Elvira, before discuss about what is textbook, what is the role of textbook in English language teaching, and then why we have to analyze the textbook. Okay, and in analyzing a textbook, there are some criteria that you can use. For example, Ms. Elvira before given to you some criteria from Mukundan, if I'm not mistaken, yeah, Ms. Elvira. And then, but the theory of analyzing textbook is not only from the Mukundan, but also from the other expert. So, how to analyze a good textbook? I make it more specific. The first one is more general, because more general here means that we, using the theory, that theory, we can analyze all of type of the textbook. Okay, for example, the theory from BSNP, there are four aspects to be analyzed. Okay, for BSNP, okay, theory, we can analyze the textbook in general one, not only for English textbook, yeah, but general textbook. And the second one is about the specific one. For example, is the theory from Mukundan, the theory from Harmer, and the theory from Bird, Cunningsworth, Little John, and etc. It means that you can analyze the textbook based on the theory. The theory is more specific to analyze the English textbook, not in general one. Okay. And then, can you show my slide? Slide-nya sudah ada belum?
Sudah, Bu.
Sudah, Miss.
Sudah ya? Oke. Okay. Criteria of a good textbook based on some expert. The first one is from Bird. He categorized the textbook into four main aspects. But in every main aspect, divided into some sub-aspect again. And then the second one is from Cunningsworth. He defined the criteria of textbook in four aspects. Okay, same as the Bird, he defined the chapter into the sub-chapter one, or sub-aspect into the sub-aspect. Little John and Tomlinson. Two criteria, Mukundan, you can see from Miss Elvira explanation before, in the Mukundan, the analysis is in form of the checklist. Okay, in Mukundan, when we want to analyze the English textbook, the criteria are more detailed. You can analyze the textbook from each skill. For example, if you want to analyze about the speaking skill, listening skill, reading skill, and then speaking skill. And also you can analyze based on the component, for example, vocabulary, grammar, and etc. And he also provide the theory how to analyze that skill and that component also. So it will be more specific if you want to analyze the textbook based on evaluation checklist from Mukundan, then BSNP. Because when we want to analyze English textbook based on BSNP, it's only general. It is only about the textbook, not the skill or not the component, or not about the readability level. Okay, and the next one, according to UR, or I a couple years ago, I have borrowed from Mr. Iwan book. It is the book is from Selsey Murcia, yeah, if I'm not mistaken. And in that book, there is a criteria from BERT about evaluation checklist also. So you can use this theory to analyze the textbook. And then next one, okay. Now I'm going to talk about textbook research. Okay. I have collect all the title from our student at UIN. Okay. Can you see? This is the title of textbook analysis research. Okay. From the total of the title here, there are 30 students who did a research about a textbook analysis. They analyzed the textbook based on BSNP, and then they analyzed textbook based on gender, cultural also, and then readability level, and then the last one is about moral value in the reading material. If I'm not mistaken, it belongs to Suhada, ya. Suhada, ya. Kalau nggak salah, moral value, ya. If I'm not mistaken, okay. This is the total of the textbook analysis from PBI UIN Real. So why I have to show to you? Because I want to make a project, little project at the end of my presentation. I will offer the student to do a research about textbook also as an alternative in this pandemic, yeah. Because if your thesis is about experimental research, I think that it will be difficult for you to do that because you have to treat the student. You have to treat the student, the problem in quota, and et cetera, and et cetera. And then in every class of the textbook, I always talk to my student in the textbook class, you can produce a thesis from your bathroom. From your bedroom, you can produce your thesis. You don't need to do pre-research. You don't need to find the appropriate strategy to be used in the class. You don't need to treat your student. You don't need to make your lesson plan and etc. And the alternative one is about a research of textbook. And I think in this moment, it will be better for you to do a research or to propose a proposal about textbook analysis one. In spite of inquiry narrative, yeah, like Miss Dewi last week and Miss Aulia and Miss Nunun, yeah, and E last week, share those four. Okay, the alternative one is the analysis textbook. Okay, so when I have seen the title of the student, like I told you before that, they do a research about textbook viewed from genre and then and also character education and blah, 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 blah. Okay, BSNP, cultural content, gender, hots and lots. Okay, in my class, for the other alternative of analyzing a textbook, they can do analyze based on Bloom taxonomy aspect. I mean that here that in the Bloom taxonomy, there are three domains. Okay, the first one is about cognitive, affective, and psychomotor, and they can choose, for example, like cognitive one. So in analyzing textbook based on hots and lots in the cognitive level, because in the Bloom taxonomy divided into in the cognitive one divided into six level. Level one and level two, level three belong to a lower level, and level four, five, and six belong to a high level. Okay, and then they can analyze this level based on the keyword and based on the type of the question or exercises from the textbook. Okay, this is the example from the Bloom taxonomy level one of cognitive level, and then this is the example how to determine which level the student, for example, level one, remembering. So the keyword for the instruction in the textbook will be choose, define, find, how, and etc. Level two, related to understanding, and the keyword or the operational word, yeah, is classify, compare, contrast, and etc. And level three is about applying. The keyword is about the keyword, yeah, apply, build, choose, construct, and the level of the and the question is, for example, like the keyword from remembering, the keyword is choose, the question is what is, and then define where is. Okay, and then for level four, yeah, level four, level five, and level six belong to higher level. At the end of the learning, the student should create something. For example, if the material is about a letter, at the end of the learning, they have to create a letter. Okay, and then this is the operational word create, yeah. For example, the question in the textbook, would you adapt, how would you adapt, or to create a different, and blah blah blah, and they can compile. Also, can you propose an alternative, for example, like that. I think that all of you know about this level, so I don't want to discuss it more, because you are the expert, yeah, especially Ms. Nurul. She is the lecturer of lesson planning, okay? And then, readability level, okay? Why we have to calculate the readability level? Because before the writer of the textbook provide the material of reading text, they should consider about the level of difficulty. It means that if you provide the reading text is difficult for your student, it can make your student misunderstanding or cannot catch the idea from the text. So it means that it is important to calculate the readability one, and your senior also have done the research about the readability. Okay, but they only analyze from or calculate from Fasking kit, yeah, reading is not the other formulation. Okay, this is the slide. Like I said before, that the readability level is to know the difficult level of your reading text. Okay, why calculate readability? I have explained to you before. It is important to the students, to the writer of the textbook to consider when they want to provide the reading, yeah, the reading text. They have to calculate it first because it will make your student easier if the content of the reading text is suitable for their level also. And then there are so many kinds of readability formula here. The readability formula, we can use some expert. It depends on your need because every formula has different purpose. Okay, phrase like phrase Kincaid reading is. Okay, you can use that one. And then phrase Kincaid grade level like Gunning's yeah, Gunning, SMOG, Dell and Cole. Okay, and then the other. So the it means that in the textbook not only provide about the material like speaking, listening and writing, but also the content of the textbook is about reading. Okay, so we can analyze the textbook not only from the criteria of a good textbook also, but also we can calculate the readability level based on the reading text provided in the textbook. Okay, kinds of readability sudah ya, comment ya, ada juga ya, based on your needs. Okay. How to calculate readability? I think for my student who join my class, it is easy to calculate readability because you can calculate it manually and you can calculate it by using formulation provided in the internet. Okay. For example, how to calculate readability level manually? You can use some formula here. I give the example. Phrase reading is formula. You in this formula, you need to know. You need to know the number of word, and also the number of sentence. How do you know the number of word? You can see from the reading text. For example, there is reading text about Cinderella in your textbook. You have to know the total of number of the sentence. Yeah, the total number of the sentence. How to calculate the total number of the sentence? If you type in the Microsoft Word at the bottom of your word, it will appear the total number of word, the total number of sentence, and then how to calculate syllable? Okay, you can use a formula. You can use application because if you want to calculate syllable one per word, it will be difficult for us to determine how many syllable in one word. Okay, this is the formula. Readability is. Okay, for example, 206.835 minus 1.015 multiplied by ASL. Okay, the ASL is the result of calculation average sentence length. Average sentence length, we can get it from the number of words divided by the number of the sentences. And ASW, we can get this number from number of syllables divided by the number of the word. So it will not so difficult to calculate a readability level. After you get the score, you can see the categorization, okay, for example, the score is about 60 from that textbook. Okay, this is the reading score. Okay, for example, the total of the score is 60, meaning that the reading text is available used for the 8 to 9 grade. If the result of your score is about 50, it means that the total reading, the categorization is for the 10 to 12 grade. This is the example if you want to calculate it manually. But if you want to calculate by using formulation, you can type all the content from the reading text. Okay, type all, and then you have to put, you have to find out in the internet the application for readability one. So after you type all the sentences in the from the reading text, you can copy and paste in the box provided in the application. You just put that on that box, and then directly the number of result readability readability form readability result will be appear. It will be more easier for you to calculate it by using formulation. And same as the manual one, after you know the total of the score from the readability one, you can check or you can categorize from the table of reading is formula. Okay. Okay, if you want to read more about readability, the expert is, if I'm not mistaken, is William Dubay. He is the expert of readability one. Okay, this is the journal, William H. Dubay or Dubay. I don't know how to pronounce Dubai or Dubai. Okay, this is one. And then how to measure readability. This is the journal of readability level. Okay. Okay, this is the journal also about the fast reading score. There are so many formula or formula to calculate readability level on your need, yeah, because each expert highlight different needs. And then my project is my project here. If Miss Mesuri agree with my project or allow us to do the same research, yeah, in textbook analysis. Okay, I have a joint project about textbook analysis because there are so not so many some students who did the research about textbook analysis. It is about cultural content, gender, moral value, BSNP, analyze the textbook based on Cunningsworth theory, Little John, Mukunda, Nation, blah, blah, blah. I will ask some students to do a research again about this, but in my Word, Microsoft Word here, the cultural content, most of the student analyze the textbook, only one textbook. Only analyze one textbook. Here, I want to ask the student to analyze more than one textbook. For example, one student analyzed three textbooks. But the theme is about cultural content also. One student analyzed the textbook from three different publishers. It is about cultural content. And one student analyzed three different textbooks viewed from the gender. And the one student analyzed English textbook from three different publisher viewed from moral value, and etc. and etc. Okay, and then okay, because when I show you this PowerPoint here, the title, the total of students who did a research about the textbook, most of them analyze only one textbook. Yeah, not many of them analyze more than one textbook. So I will repeat the same title of the thesis, but they have to analyze based on, analyze the textbook from three different publishers. Yeah, because your senior has done a research about textbook only from one publisher. Okay, the next project is about teacher perspective. Yeah, analysis of textbook. We look from the teacher perspective, student perspective, and then parent perspective. So it means that you will have a kind of questionnaire or interview the teacher or interview the student related to the use of English textbook in their class. Okay, and I hope that not umbrella, but join research, yeah, Miss Isti. So, for point number one, you have to analyze textbook from gender, and you have to analyze more than two textbooks, and you compare the result of your analysis. The advisors will be me and Mr. Agus. And then point two, three, and four, the advisor will be me and Miss Nunun. If Miss May will appoint us as the advisor. Oh, Miss May agree with my project. Because it will make a student more easier to do research in this pandemic situation. The alternative one for doing a research in this Corona situation. Okay, I think that's enough. That's all from me. And thank you. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. I give back to Miss Nunun as the moderator.
Miss Nunun. Oh, Miss Nunun terlempar ternyata. Sebentar. Atau Miss Emma selama hari menunggu Miss Nunun udah kembali. Ya udah. Welcome back, sorry.
Habis hilang. Okay, thank you, Ms. Ramatillah. Now we move to the last speaker. Ada Mr. Agus wants to present the materials. 30 minutes, ya, Mr. Time is yours.
Okay. Yeah, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you very much.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
For the moderator and PBI for holding this webinar and also for the all of the participants. I'd like to continue the explanation from I would like to discuss something that is related to the previous discussion from Ms. Elvira and from Matilda. Can I start the screen sharing? I'd like to discuss about the content analysis, yeah, because this is have a correlation with the textbook analysis, because one of the things that can be analyzed in the content analysis is textbook. One of the many things that can be discussed in content analysis is textbook. That's why I would like to talk a little just the introduction of content analysis. Okay, first, since we are facing the same problem now, which is the COVID-19 pandemic that limit our movement, yeah, in many aspects, this kind of research proposed or give us an opportunity to or an option to conduct a research for students, especially because the nature of this research is really suitable to be applied now in this pandemic. The nature of the content analysis is unobtrusive. Unobtrusive mean it can be done without contacting the outside world. We don't have to come to the in this kind of research, we don't have to come to the school, we don't have to find the teacher or students or to meet them to have an interview, because this research can be done from your own room, for example, from your own house. So you don't have to meet anyone. The point is you don't have to meet anyone to finish this research. So this is very helpful in this situation. That's why this is something that I propose, yeah, for the students to do. Okay, next, let's talk about the content analysis. There are many definitions, there are many theories based on, it depends on what books you read. Basically, the point is that content analysis is a technique or a method technique or a method in studying and analyzing communication in a text. So not only book, but text. Two of the most famous, the most common theories referred to by the researcher of content analysis, the one from Halstey and Krippendorf. It states that the content analysis is an objective and systematic identification of characteristic of message in a text. So we can analyze text here. We can analyze the communication, the pattern, the communication, the characteristic of message. So there are many things that can be analyzed here. For example, the most famous aspects that can the most common aspect that can be analyzed based on Halstey's theory, there are 15 things that can be analyzed here. For example, the from Ms. Ramatila explanation earlier, for example, the readability also later also the what is it the the screenshot, screenshot is screenshot of the theory from Halstey. There are 15 things that can be analyzed. in this kind of research. Now, the objective is to transform a large amount of text into highly concise and organized summary of key results. So, to transform, to minimize until we get only the things that we want to get, only the keys of the information that is relevant for the our research. And then, what kind of text that can be analyzed here? Since I mentioned earlier that it is not only book, but also many things. For example, visual. We can analyze a photograph, as simple as photograph, movie, TV programs, something visual, and then verbal, an article from a newspaper, a section of from a magazine or books, and then visual print, for example, cartoon, drawings, illustration, and then the personal document, like personal letters, official document, and diary, autobiography. There are many things actually that can be analyzed, depending on what your interest. Maybe you want, if you want to analyze the content of a biography, or a legal document, or even a poster. The message or communication aspect of a poster, you can analyze that. Because text, because the one that is analyzed in content analysis is text, yeah. And books is one of kind of text. It can be speeches, it can be radio program or subtitle, or many things. And then types. There are two types of content. There are two types of content that can be analyzed. The first is manifest content, and the second is latent content. Manifest content is in Indonesia, for example, harfiah, ya. Nah, harfiah manifest content. It is observable. For example, the words contained in a text or in a passage, the phrases, the clauses, the idioms. And then the second is the latent content. There is the underlying meaning beyond the something, beyond the observable thing. Because the latent content analyze the underlying meaning of manifest itself. So the meaning behind the literal meaning and how it affects. How it is affected by social, cultural, and social significance and linguistic aspects, and many other things. Okay, so there are two types of content, so the literal and latent, manifest and latent content. And next, let's talk about the direction. So there are two. So this is arah, ya, arah penelitian. The first is conceptual, and the second is relational. Conceptual, establishing the existence and frequency of concept, most often represented by words or of phrases in a text. So the first course of content analysis is the conceptual. So if you want to know how often words is written in a text, for example, or you want to investigate how many types of concept present in the text, you can take this direction, so the conceptual. So if you want to check the frequency or seberapa sering, seberapa banyak, atau adakah suatu konsep, adakah suatu kata in a text, then you can take this conceptual analysis. For example, this is a simple example of content analysis. You want to know how often an author uses terms that express joy, for example. So basically you count the words that represent joy or the joy word itself. You count how many, the percentages, for example. What's that express joy in another? For example, like happy, merry, joyful, or jolly. You confirm whether there are words that represent joy in a text and the frequency. That is conceptual. process. And then the second is relational analysis. This is one step further because this relational analysis analyzes beyond the word. From the earlier example, for example, from the joy word. So in this type of in relational analysis, you could identify when or in what context. Yeah, when or what context? For example, the word joy when it is used, and then the effect on the reader or the development of the story, something like that. This is beyond counting, beyond confirming. So we relate in relational analysis. We relate the words with a social aspect, for example, economic aspect. Later, I'll provide you one example of that. And then, why should we conduct this research? Because it is unobtrusive, obviously. You don't have to interact with anyone. You can do this in your own room, in your own house, without leaving your room. You can do this research, and it is flexible. Yeah, it can be anytime, in any location. Low cost also. However, there are things that become the advantages of this research. The first is subjectivity, because the researcher itself is the instrument, maybe here, and then the result or the content of the research itself is depends on the researcher's perspective. So it can be subjective, it can result in bias. And then time consuming, if the text that you choose consists of many pages, for example, if it is a book, so it will be time consuming. Actually, there are some option in conducting this research. You don't have to analyze the context, the text manually. It can be assisted by computer program or internet program also, especially in the coding section, in the coding stage of this research. It can be helpful in reducing the time of the research. And then, as many other research, there are procedure of content analysis. Although this is general, not specific to one types of concept, the conceptual or relational analysis. This is the general procedure. First, you have to identify the research questions, select the content, coding, and then drawing conclusion. I believe you are familiar with this part here, identifying research questions, be clear and direct. You state what you want to know, things that you want to, what your research want to be focused on, and then select the content. After you identify the focus, let's say the focus of your research, the things that you want to investigate, you select the content. Where do you want to get the data from? From a newspaper, for example, or books, and then specify the books, what kind of books, what kind of newspaper, for example, the only English written newspaper, from what year to what year. So you have to specify that and select the content, the source of the data. And then next is do the coding. Coding, it means that you categorize the data. You categorize the data, you read the text, and then group or categorize the data into the respective groups. So the common method of coding for conceptual research is deductive or inductive coding. And then the last is drawing conclusion. So after you examine the pattern, you can draw the conclusion that you present the content of your analysis. And then the sample. There are many. This is not a new type of research. This is quite old. Actually, content analysis. Thus, many research have been conducted using the content analysis. For example, one of them is from Emmy Ramawati Mada. Content analysis on English in focus and an English textbook for 7-year students of junior high school. We can see the formulation here. In this research, she investigated whether or not the language skill material in English in focus compatible with indicator of language skill based on school-based curriculum. This is belong to the conceptual analysis because she want to investigate, we want to confirm whether the text itself, the books in this case, content all the aspects of school-based curriculum. So basically, she wants to count and confirm. So that's the nature, I think, nature of conceptual analysis. And then the second is the same. This is similar. Content analysis of 2013 curriculum textbook. So whether it is suitable to be used in vocational schools curriculum. It's a scientific approach, yeah? And the focus is scientific approach based curriculum in 2000. And then the sample of relational content analysis, relational, yeah? The one that beyond the word. Does what you say affect your project's success? In this research, Natasha focuses her research on the effect of narcissistic rhetoric, praises, whether it will be able to influence more people. She helped a fundraiser here. The website. Something like kitabisa.com, something like that. So she analyzed the description. Analyze the description of the fundraiser, and then she identified the narcissistic rhetoric there, and then she compared the result, whether the one that used narcissistic rhetoric in the description will get more fun from the one that didn't apply the narcissistic. So this is beyond the word. I think she investigated the effect of communication with the real world. And then if you are interested in this type of research, there are some books that is commonly used by researchers as reference. Especially this one, Content Analysis, an Introduction to Its Methodology from Krippendorf. And then this is a book, Content Analysis for Social Science and Communities. In these two books, you can find the specific procedure. You can find the method, in selecting the books, and many other things that should be considered in content analysis. Okay, maybe that's all that I that's all that I can share with the audience. And now I'll give back to the moderator. Thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you, Mr. Agus. It's really interesting materials. And now we go to the question and answer session. But I'm sorry, saya kehilangan beberapa jejak chat karena tadi sempat leave, ya, sempat kehilangan sinyal. So someone can help me to find the question yang belum terjawab, ada apa tidak ya di chat box? Okay, maybe the first is from Suhada ya. To Ms. Rahmatillah, do the researcher must do trustworthiness by another person or the expert? If I take an analysis in writing task based on nation theory in the textbook. Gimana ini Ms. Rahmatillah?
Okay, thank you Ms. Nanon and Suhada. I have told you before, we have to do trustworthiness the data to validate the finding of your research, because the more challenging one in analyzing textbook is about the result of your analysis itself. It not depend on your opinion, but also you have to recheck the result of your analysis by checking the other source. For example, you can ask trustworthiness here mean yeah, valid ini ya. Tingkat tingkat apa? Keabsahan apa sih bahasa Indonesianya?
Tingkat keabsahan data.
Benar enggak sih keabsahan bahasa Indonesia? Validasi. Yeah, you need to ask someone else to validate the finding. So the result is not from your opinion also, but also you can ask the AI. And if I take analysis in writing task based on national theory in the textbook, yes, you can, yeah, that's your title, if I'm not mistaken, yes, Wada, because you are my student. if I take an analysis in writing task, okay, based on nation theory in the textbook. Okay, in analyzing textbook based on nation theory provides some criteria of the writing task, right? For example, in writing task, the student should write, for example, a composition about descriptive text, for example. And then the instruction, you can see from the instruction ya Suhada ya, di situ kan ada instructionnya. Instructionnya apa? Ya, instructionnya apa? Apakah kalau nggak salah di nation itu apa? Karena kebanyakan teori ya bingung jadi nation. Apa? Ya, Suhada, can you make it more specific? The question, if I take analysis in writing task itu maksudnya apa? Can you make it more specific your question, Suhada? I have explained to the your first question. You have to do.
Oh, ini Miss Emma, Suhada, you can unmute yourself and then ask directly to Miss Rahmatillah.
Ya, maksud yang keduanya itu apa? If I take, I think that if you analyze all the content of the textbook, you have to validate the result of your analysis, not only from the nation theory, but also from the SNP, Mapundan, yeah. You have to validate the result to make it more, because the result of your analysis is not based on your opinion, but you have to recheck the other expert to validate the finding of your data. Ya, mungkin itu ya. Nation theory, mau nation, mau dia mukundan, tetap. That's, how about the other? Miss Elvira?
Ya, yeah, maybe Miss Elvira and
Mr. Agus want to add something?
Or Suhada wants to speak directly? Tidak ada tanda-tanda ya. Okay, for the audience who wants to ask to the speaker, just write on the chat box.
Okay,
I think that pertanyaan lagi?
Mr. Said.
Dari Mr. Said, ada hal yang harus dipenuhi untuk validasi data kualitatif atau trustworthiness. Bagaimana cara memenuhi empat hal tersebut, Bu Rahmatilah?
Okay, I think for this question, you can ask Mr. Agus, because in this part, Mr. Agus explained about content analysis. He is the expert of methodology also, Mr. Said. Yang confirmability itu ya, yang ini kalau nggak salah ya, kalau yang data itu. Okay, Mr. Agus, please answer Mr. Said question. If I'm not mistaken, one of them is about confirmability. Kalau nggak salah, terus apa-apa, I forgot.
Mr. Said, specifically as to Mr. Matiwa. Maybe you should try to answer the question.
I will ask your help, Mr. Agus. So if I explain it not clear, okay, it will make my sense to my student if the my explanation is not clear about the validation or trustworthiness of the data. I think it will be better someone who expert in answering Mr. Said question.
Yeah, or maybe from Miss Elvira, do you want to say something about Mr. Said's questions? Miss Elvira, are you there?
Yes. Oh, maaf, tadi izin sebentar. Pertanyaan?
Ya, ada hal yang harus dipenuhi untuk validasi data kualitatif. Bagaimana cara memenuhi empat hal tersebut? Can you give example?
Trustworthiness, ya, untuk data kualitatif. Ini tidak hanya berlaku untuk di textbook analysis. Maksudnya ini konteksnya textbook analysis atau gimana, Mr. Said?
Mr. Said, or maybe you can bisa dihubungkan dengan textbook analysis karena bahasan ini adalah textbook analysis.
Gimana ya saya menjawabnya?
in general and textbook.
In general, kalau di secara general kan trustworthiness itu kita bisa menggunakan beberapa basic strategies ya. Biasanya dari yang proposed by Miriam itu menggunakan triangulation itu this method used to confirm the emerging the finding ya, kalau tadi di bisa dari questionnaire ya, observation, kemudian interview, kemudian yang selanjutnya itu bisa menggunakan member checking. Ini member checking biasanya kita mengambil data kemudian kita kembalikan lagi ke partisipan ya, dan menanyakan lagi, mengkonfirmasi apakah hasil dari questionnaire kemudian tadi interview itu memang sudah sesuai ya, nggak bias gitu. Itu kemudian yang selanjutnya harusnya Mr. Said yang ahli ini ya, riset method.
Mr. Said, what is your opinion about that? How to fulfill the criteria? Those criteria, what is your opinion? Mr. Said, what is your opinion about how to fulfill those criteria?
Empat hal itu apa saja ya? What is four things yang dimaksud itu?
In my students, when they provide the theory of the trustworthiness, ya, yeah, confirmability, ya, yeah, ya, yeah, itu yang disebutkan Mr. Said. Tapi saya lupa yang trisanya, confirmability yang saya I have told you before, credibility, transferability, and dependability. Lagi pakai lotion abis mandi, okay, Mr. Said, can you explain to us what is meant by credibility, transferability, dependability, and conformability. Yeah, Mr. Said.
Yeah, maybe you can share something about it, or maybe from another lecturer. Dan mahasiswa yang mau bertanya, silahkan.
I would like to ask to add. Since I discussed the content analysis, that actually in content analysis, it heavily emphasized on the word coders. Yeah, in content analysis, all of those things that Mr. Said mentioned can be fulfilled by having multiple coders in content analysis based on the theory that I read. So there should be more than one coders or researcher in the content analysis. That's how you can check many things in the content analysis, from the truth value until the four that Mr. mentioned, until the last is the objectivity. We can confirm that or do that using coders. Yeah, actually, you need other people to help you in coding or to check the result of your coding. That's what I know in content analysis, especially. Okay, that's it.
Can
enlighten us. Yeah, something like that.
Okay, we ask for other experts to validate our result, gitu ya, Mister, ya?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, another questions, please. Tadi saya tertarik dengan materials from Mr. Agus about analyzing the visual, visual source, ada gambar dan sebagainya. I want to ask how to determine the visual that is required in the context of PBI, untuk menghubungkan dengan konteks PBI itu visual source-nya yang seperti apa, apakah ada syarat-syaratnya, and how to select it.
Basically, for the researcher, especially for the PBI students, you have to know first. That's why the first step in conducting this research is constructing the research question, because you have to know what do you want to know, what do you want to your research to be focused on. That, and then later, the second step is choosing content. If you want to find the values in movies, you have to know what you can movies, and then categorize the movies or choose one of the movies or TV or posters or flyer or many things. Basically, first, you have to know your research questions.
Okay.
After that, you select the source.
Yeah, so we have to determine our research goal first before we select the materials. Yeah. Is it possible if we select one picture? Kalau movie kan banyak yang bisa di ini ya, bisa dianalisis. How about picture? Single picture without any caption or without any text. Is it possible?
Of course it is possible. Because that kind of research has been done before, and maybe the students have some interesting idea about a picture can be developed into content analysis. For example, a picture of an ad, for example, an ad or a picture of a student studying English in a situation, for example. If there are things that can be analyzed from the picture, then why not? Although one thing that must be considered that our study program or PBI emphasize on the connection with the education. So if a single picture you think cannot represent or cannot affect, yeah, can give contribution to the world of education or English education, then I advise you to find another thing to be.
Dekat lagi dengan context of English education, ya. Okay, any other question, ya? From Miss Isti to Mr. Agis. Berarti bisa pakai photo voice seperti yang pekan kemarin dibahas team listening.
Ya, yeah. Anything can be researched on as long as it is considered a text. Yeah, it don't have to be written word. It can be voice. It can be picture, it can be anything. Yeah, there are so many options actually. There are many things. Speeches, for example, you want to know what's the speeches? Do so. Or an app, yeah, advertisement, a flyer, many things.
Yeah. Ini ada tambahan dari Mr. Said. Masih yang tadi ya, sebenarnya banyak cara atau teknik untuk memenuhi empat hal tersebut. Seperti credibility, bisa pakai member check, transferability, bisa dengan dependability, dengan melakukan audit atau evaluasi prosedur penelitian, atau dengan konsultasi dengan dosen lain atau dosen pembimbing. Ya, seperti yang tadi dijelaskan Mr. Agus ya. And then confirmability, dengan memastikan prosesnya dilakukan dengan benar. Sesuai prosedur. Okay. Berarti to make sure that the process is right, itu gimana ini?
You should read the books, the proposed by Mr. Said.
Yeah, Mr. Said, mungkin bisa speech directly to us to share your
Hola. Lotion
mata ya. Mantap. Belum selesai ya lotionnya ya.
Jadi nambahin aja. Nanti bisa dibaca bareng-bareng ya. Kalau misalnya ada yang salah, nanti bisa cross-check bareng. Jadi kalau misalnya kayak tadi yang credibility itu banyak, ada beberapa. Kayak misalnya market triangulasi juga bagian dari credibility-nya. Bisa pakai member check lain. Kalau misalnya transferability itu kayak pernyataan dari si apa namanya penelitinya bahwasanya sebagai penelitian ya, nanti itu bisa di apa namanya terapkan di tempat lain dan hasilnya konsisten atau sama. Kalau misalnya yang dependability-nya itu masih tadi, nah itu biasanya pakai audit. Jadi kita nggak bisa kan kalau nggak salah itu apa, mahasiswa yang datang ke dosen lain kemudian minta cek ini hasil analisisnya bagaimana, nah itu masuk ke dependability-nya. Atau dari dosen pembimbing sendiri, gitu kan. Kan itu sudah divalidasi sama dosennya. Sudah dicek sama dosennya, ini datanya gimana, ini sudah sesuai atau belum. Nah, itu adalah proses dari dependability-nya sendiri. Terus kalau misalnya confirmability-nya memastikan prosesnya, nah, itu biasanya di bab 3, itu kan dijelaskan tuh, prosedur penelitiannya, prosedur penelitiannya. Nah, nanti dicek apakah prosedur penelitiannya itu sudah dilakukan berdasarkan yang sudah dinyatakan di bab 3-nya. Oke. Okay. Yang simple kok, cuma lebih subjektif aja gitu, karena mostly untuk credibility-nya yang tiga hal, satu dari tiga atau dua dari empat, satu dari empat atau dua dari empat, itu dari si apa namanya peneliti sendiri yang meyakinkan bahwasannya yang dia lakukan itu sudah benar, sudah sesuai prosedur, sudah sesuai prosesnya sudah benar. Okay, thank you.
Okay, yeah, thank you very much. It's really useful for us. So in doing content analysis, we have to pay attention for those things yang baru saja dijelaskan oleh Mr. Said. Okay, thank you. Ya, ada lagi yang mau bertanya? Silakan, Bapak Ibu dosen atau mahasiswa.
Oh ya, tadi ada yang minta contoh apa? Hots and Lots ya, Aulia atau siapa ya? Nurul ya?
Oh ya, oh ya, banyak itu tadi yang chat. Silahkan Bu Romatina.
Ya. Oke, okay. For the example of Hots and Lots, there were some students who do the research about that. They analyze from the skills, for example, and then they are still ongoing research. Masih ongoing tapi. But if you want to ask me about the example, there are so many example of analyzing textbook based on Hots and Lots. You can find it in the internet. Banyak sebenarnya. But I have one. But I have to check my document first in the talk. But I have the example of analyzing textbook based on Hots and Lots. But if you want to ask me about the example from our student, the result of their research, their research are still ongoing. Ya, kalau misalkan, okay, I will explain to you about join research. Okay, Miss Istia. Okay, join research here. Me or some advisor to be, if Miss may allow us to do join research, I will not point the student, but if you are interested to do a research about textbook, you can contact me. But the procedure of the join for the join research here, I will provide some title of the textbook analysis research, and then the student only do the research. Okay, and you have to provide the theory, same as your senior, yeah, who do the research about the textbook. But I have to divide some material or some title of the research. For example, you have to do a research about cultural content. Okay. Here that, for example, I will choose, for example, three students who will do the research. A student will do the research about cultural content, and with the same publisher, with the other students, yeah. For example, student A do a research about cultural content, and the publishers are Erlangga, Yudhistira, and Intan Pariwara, for example. They have to analyze the textbook viewed from the cultural content. And then the students B do the research about textbook also, but the time will be different. They have to analyze based on gender, but they have to analyze the same book as student A. Okay, and the last one, the student will do the research about gender. Oh, gender tadi sudah ya, apa? For example, about moral value in the reading text. Okay, moral value in the reading text. They have to analyze the different publisher, but same as the student A and B. So, for example, only three students. And then, that's the first research about title of the research from gender and from I forget cultural gender and then apa moral value, and then the second one is about the research of teacher perspective in using textbook. Then second one is the research of the textbook analysis of students' perspective in using textbook, and the last one, the teacher perspective in using textbook. Okay. They have to do those research Okay, students A about teacher's perspective. The second is about students' perspective, and the last one is about parent perspective. Why I take the title is the problem that the parent perspective, because I have my own experience when I taught my children at SDIT, they only provide LK, lembar kerja. And the content of the LK is only a limited number of explanation about the material. And as the parents, I felt that it is difficult for me to find out the other source of the material. For example, the material is about binatang berkaki empat, or the material is about present about noun, if I give the example in English. So I have to find out the other theory related to noun. So noun, as we know that when we discuss about noun, there are so many type of nouns, kind of noun, abstract noun and concrete noun and blah blah blah. So if the teacher doesn't limit the material, the parents will find the material not based on the syllabus. Okay, and then so it means that I want to know about the parents' perspective of using English textbook parents' perspective in using the textbook when they teach their children. And about the next one is about the teacher perspective, whether the textbook can help them to organize the material in delivering the material in the textbook, because as we know that the textbook is only not only media for teaching, but also the content of the textbook. There are so many material to be discussed in our teaching learning process also. And about the students, whether the textbook can help them to master the core skill of English, to master the component of English. That's the general point of my project for textbook analysis research.
Okay, Ms. Rahmatillah. So if I conclude from your presentation, in the upcoming project, you will conduct research related to textbook analysis. The first is about content, and the second is about the perspective, gitu ya. The content will consist of three subtopic. Tadi ada apa? Cultural content, gender, and moral value.
But if the student feel I'm not interested in doing the research about the gender, they can choose the other alternative. For example, they can analyze based on Mukundan or based on Harmer, up to them, based on their need also.
Oh yeah, jadi poinnya for the first project is about content. Apapun kontennya dilihat apa saja yang melibatkan satu sudut pandang satu mahasiswa gitu ya.
But the most important thing, they have to analyze the textbook from three different publishers, because most of the student who did the research about the textbook, they only analyze one book. I want to ask them to do a research by comparing the three different textbook, but view from the same perspective from, for example, gender and blah 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 blah.
So this is the first project, and then the second is about the perspective of textbook yang dilihat dari tiga pandangan tadi. Jadi intinya nanti akan ada two big project from this.
Two big project, but if the other student I think it will be more than six students. We the students are interested to do research about this, the procedure or the step I will explain to them later.
Itu jadi mahasiswa yang interested to join Miss Rahmatilla's project about textbook analysis. She needs at least 6 students.
But before that, I want to ask Miss May permission because some of the time already already done by our student. For example, it is about gender or cultural content, But their analysis, they only analyze one textbook. The same topic, but they have to use or they have to compare 3 books, not only one book. If Miss May, as our cadre, allow me or allow us to do the same research, but they have to use 3 kinds of different publisher.
I think it's a good news. So for the students, you can prepare. Kalau memang nanti deal, kapan lagi ya kan bisa project bareng dosen bermalah, kan? Okay, ini ada tambahan dari Mr. Derry di chat box. Beberapa jurnal yang kebetulan secara terpaksa tak baca, nggak memenuhi 4 kriteria di atas, tapi sebagai gantinya mereka dengan cukup santai mencantumkannya dalam keterbatasan penelitian. Okay, so this is from Mr. Derry's experience. Ada fenomena tidak memenuhi 4 kriteria tadi. Ini kira-kira gimana? What's your opinion? The speakers.
Cukup santai mencantumkannya. Okay. The suggestion, Miss, is this suggestion? There is a subchapter or in the discussion ada pengakuan dosa.
Pengakuan dosa.
They don't do the right procedure in doing the research. Nah, itu tadi bagus juga tuh ada pengakuan dosa. Tapi ngaku enggak kalau memang enggak ngerjain? Masalahnya ngaku enggak?
Olah, boleh nambah.
Okay,
thank you Mr. Derry. Okay, kalau memang untuk yang tadi ya, kalau ada peneliti yang tidak memenuhi unsur itu, tapi dia memasukkannya ke dalam keterbatasan penelitian, itu emang benar. Jadi semua penelitian yang secara tidak langsung tidak kita lakukan prosesnya, itu dinyatakannya di bagian keterbatasan penelitian ini. Karena memang di situ tempat pengakuan dosanya. Jadi apapun hasil penelitian kita mau bagus banget, tapi kalau misalnya ada part-part yang kita skip atau yang tidak dilakukan dan dinyatakan dalam penelitian apa dalam keterbatasan penelitian, nanti itu biar reviewernya kalau di jurnal ya atau di jurnal itu biar reviewernya yang judging nanti kira-kira karena keterbatasan itu apa penelitian yang dilakukan oleh si penulis ini bisa dianggap layak sekali atau tidak layaknya gitu kan, karena memang ada part-part atau ada unsur-unsur yang tidak dimasukkan. Kira-kira sih seperti itu aja gambarannya. Bisa aja reviewer yang menilai atau pembaca sendiri yang menilai. Oh ternyata proses yang dilakukan oleh peneliti ini atau ada unsur yang tidak dilakukan oleh si peneliti ini. Jadi nanti hasilnya ya nanti yang bisa judging, bisa menilainya itu ya si penulisnya itu. Jadi kalau misalnya memang mau dinyatakan dalam ini ya monggo silakan, itu malah bagus banget gitu. Berarti dia menyadari bahwasanya penelitian dia ini tidak sempurna, ada kekurangannya di sini. Nah bisa saja nanti penelitian selanjutnya akan melakukan penelitian untuk menutupi kekurangan yang dilakukan oleh si peneliti tersebut. Nah itu jadi peluang untuk melakukan penelitian lain gitu kan. Tercover oleh si peneliti yang sekarang. Gitu. Itu aja kayaknya. Terima kasih. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Mr. Said. Jadi section pengakuan dosa itu bagus juga ya in jurnal, dalam menulis jurnal, dan artikel di jurnal juga ada penilainya, reviewer tadi ya, jadi yang bisa menilai itu reviewer jurnal, atau kalau memang tidak ada reviewernya bisa penulis sendiri apakah jurnal ini layak atau tidak. Jadi kembali ke pembaca masing-masing, whether it is good or not good article. Oke.
Novelty katanya Miss Isti. Apa? Novelty kalau kata Pak Muhasin, research gap-nya bisa jadi novelty.
Oh ya, oke. Okay. Ada corresponding email di tiap jurnal. Kalau penulis berani menulis kontaknya di jurnal tersebut, berarti penulis siap menjawab pertanyaan. Oke, okay. Ya. Yeah. Novelty.
Tapi
ya,
kalau kayak gitu ada pengakuan dosa bisa jadi excuse researcher sebenarnya, yeah, ya. Nah itu kayak mana itu jadi excuse-nya researcher? Kalau, oh nggak ini gitu. Gimana itu Gus?
Asalkan alasannya bukan karena males ya. Males atau enggak?
Betul sekali.
Nah, kalau alasannya males, kalau di research development ya, R&D, itu biasanya dari yang work angle itu pasti step ketujuh itu yang jadi excuse, apa dissemination. Jadi hampir, ya, hampir semua R&D itu pasti excuse-nya ya karena the limitation of time sama biaya ya. Kalau memang limitation ya memang ada kesulitan untuk karena kalau di R&D itu dissemination artinya kan kalau dia buat buku mencetak ya kemudian memasarkan lah itu. Kalau memang tidak ada kemampuan untuk itu ya mungkin bisa lah dimaklumi. Tapi kalau karena deadline mepet, karena males, karena nggak paham, itu baru yang excuse yang nggak benar, nggak boleh.
Kalau ya, saya banyak excuse-nya karena males kelihatannya itu nanti.
Dipertahankan, lanjutkan.
Pertahankan, mau les dulu saya, les masak.
Oke. Okay. Ya, ada lagi yang mau ditanyakan? From the audience.
Oh, tadi kayaknya Dewi ada ini ya. Dewi, bisa ya textbook apa Dewi sih? Mana harus scroll ke atas sih, Dewi. Mana nih? Dewi, bisa ya?
Confusion, just make confusion.
Mbak Dewi, itu
cuma confusion, tambahan dari Dewi gitu ya? Bukan nanya. Oh iya, iya iya.
Mana ya? Oh ya ini. From textbook we can do many kinds of research. Qualitative textbook analysis, critical discourse. Okay. Narrative inquiry. Ya, ada lagi yang mau bertanya? Link sertifikat sudah di-share di grup chat, bisa diakses untuk mendapatkan sertifikatnya for the audience.
Ya. Gimana cara dapetin sertifikat, Sardos? Hah? Saya... Mr. Sakit, kalau mau dapat sertifikat sebagai narasumber, minggu depan itu duit sama Bu Melinda, riset metodologi, baru dapat sertifikat Sados. Not as the participant, but presenter, Mr. or speaker. Ya itu, jangan audience, geng.
Ya, kita tunggu Mr. Said for the next speaker ya. Gitu ya, Mr. Said. For next session. Oke, sudah jam, ya kurang 3 menit nih. Kurang 3 menit menuju jam 12. Silakan masih dibuka sesi pertanyaan. sesi tanya jawab related to this topic, textbook analysis, content analysis.
Okay, Miss Nunun, I will add something because I forgot to deliver
one. Silakan.
Okay, a couple years ago, the books analysis subject there is an idea to omit or delete the textbook analysis subject by jurusan. And one of the lecturer was asking me why the textbook analysis is important in our curriculum. We can see from the theory there and the fact there, it is needed by the the teacher to be able to analyze the textbook before they use in the class, because all the teacher here use textbook as their as the guidance in teaching and learning process. You can imagine that if we don't use a textbook in the class when we teach something, materinya akan melebar ya. Apa sih bahasa Inggrisnya melebar kemana-mana? So,
jadi nggak fokus gitu ya?
Ya, jurusan have to prepare the our student to be able to analyze the textbook, English textbook, before they are going to use in the class, because our student will be a teacher later. Ya, kan kita sebenarnya maunya students-nya itu jadi English teacher kan? So, when I did my PPL, I saw that not many teacher know about how to analyze the textbook, because in UNILA, at UNILA, there is no subject about the textbook. So I don't know they analyze the textbook or not before they use it in the class. And then, as I know that some teacher, they have to cooperate to some publisher and they can get profit from selling the textbook, but in selling the textbook without analyze the content of the textbook, because as the teacher, they have to analyze the content of the textbook, the appropriateness between the material also from the syllabus. For example, if the syllabus mention about or in the syllabus there are some material about narrative, descriptive, and they have to check whether in the textbook is there any that material, yeah, to know the appropriateness between the material in the textbook and the material from the syllabus also. Yeah, like that one. And readability level, I want to add something why it is so important as the writer of the English textbook to do to calculate the readability. It is for to provide the reading material, whether the reading material is suitable for the grade of your student. If the reading text is too difficult for your student, you can imagine that your student cannot catch the point from the reading text also. So the publisher and the writer of the textbook should consider the readability level, because the readability level is the reading is the difficult level of the text. From my experience when I taught textbook analysis, most of my students, I asked them to calculate the readability level, and the fact, the result of their calculation, most of the reading text on the textbook are not appropriate with the level of the students. But for SMK student, a half of reading text are appropriate, but from the level of the student. But for SMU, reading level, yeah, I mean, are not appropriate. For example, there are 10 text reading text. The result of that, only one or two texts are appropriate with the level. It means that not many publishers or the writer of the textbook considered about the readability level before they include the material in the textbook. Okay, I think that's my adding explanation about the textbook analysis, why it is important, and why it is important we have to calculate the level of reading text before it is used for our student in the class also. Thank you, Ms. Nunun.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Ramadillah, for the explanation. Yes, it's really important for pre-service teacher to be able to evaluate which textbook is appropriate for their students. Salah satunya difasilitasi dengan textbook course ya di UBI. Well, any other addition from others? Tidak ada?
Miss Nunun, saya kasih sudah jam dulu ya.
Oke, silakan.
Ya, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih untuk teman-teman dosen dan juga adik-adik mahasiswa. Maaf ya kalau itu ada suara azan. Tapi itu mengingatkan kita untuk menutup sesi ini sebenarnya. Hanya saja informasi pekan depan akan ada series yang ke-6, yaitu sharing dosen dengan tema research methodology, tapi kita hanya akan membahas tentang introduction. So, how to write an introduction in chapter 1 dengan narasumber insya Allah Bu Melinda Rosa, ya kan, one of our beloved lecturers. So please tell your friends that for those who hasn't got their title or already have an accepted title but they don't know how to start their chapter 1, you should watch that podcast next week. Thank you, Ms. Nunun.
Okay, you're welcome, Ms. Istiqomah. Yeah, so we come to the last session, closing, because it is 12 o'clock. Thank you for the speakers who share interesting materials, and also thanks for the audience here who joined from beginning until the end. And I'm really sure that you got something beneficial from this podcast. And we meet again for next week's podcast with other speaker. Saya mohon maaf juga if I do mistakes during being a moderator. Saya tutup. Thank you. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you. Goodbye everyone.
Maunya ada musik ini pas ditutup kayak gini.
Mana nih?
Ya, dan misalnya
operator, silakan operator.
Silakan ambil screenshot.
Oh iya, kita foto session dulu belum ya tadi ya.
Pada keluar telat. Udah telat, Pak.
Sengaja kayaknya.
Ya, silakan dibuka layarnya masing-masing dan perlihatkan wajah. Yeah. Mr. Said, semuanya.
Kayaknya semuanya udah left.
Kemarin yang
gabungan. Tuh kan muncul ya kalau ada foto.
Lolonya pas sesi foto.
Mr. Said, handuknya masih ya? Oh, bukan handuk itu ya. Hoodie ya?
Udi itu kali.
Ya, Mbak Isti, tolong di screenshot ya.
Oke, okay, bentar. Ini tapi cuma segini ya, Mama ya.
17. Mr. Derry, Miss Is.
Miss Nurul lagi ngasuh. Astaga. Aduh, sabar.
Gue pakai mukena dulu.
Oh iya, pakai mukena.
Pakai baju kebangsaan, gak apa-apa.
Oke. Bentar. Miss Nurul bener lagi enggak mau nih, Miss Is juga, Miss Dian. Mr. Derek. Enggak layak background tapi kan wajah layak kan?
Oh, Ayo.
Oke, okay. Satu, dua, oke.
Okay.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank
you.
Thank you. Operatornya siapa?
Oh, mau apa? Minta dia apa? Minta dikit. Minta dikit.
Thank you.